Hey, welcome back to 120B, 220B. Today in session 12, we're going to continue talking about both model integration and structural systems. Particularly, we're going to kind of go through the steps of doing structural analysis. So we'll go through and take some simple models and go through and try to apply some loads to them and size them up using some structural analysis tools to get some feedback about how good, how big they should actually be. This is something that you'll ultimately be doing for your project too. Okay, on a section of your project. I should comment right up front that doing structural analysis for a full structure is a very big task. So just to give you a taste of what it's like, even going through and choosing a few frames and some beams and some columns and just trying to figure out the beam sizes is probably sufficient for what we're after. You know, the same principle would apply to basically export the model and do a very full structural analysis by someone who's very capable with the structural analysis tools. That's kind of beyond the scope of where we are. So we'll just kind of dip our toe in and see how it works so that you can be an educated consumer and know as you're talking to your structural engineer what they are capable of, even though they may have to go through and do the implementation for you. Okay, so let's go ahead and start out though, just talking about, for finishing up the whole topic of model integration, we sort of left it there last time and we were playing around in BIM 360. An environment which hopefully let us go through and just try walking through and exploring different models. So what I'm gonna do is even this, let me go ahead and push that out of the way for right now. All of a sudden I'm very confused. Come back over here. In the BIM 360 environment, which I have open in the background here, theoretically, you should have a bunch of different projects out there, including ones that have your name associated with them. So if you log into BIM 360, and let's kind of, again, show you how you do that. You can either do that by, if you have a BIM 360 glue icon on your desktop, just double-clicking that, and it'll go right into the application. If you don't happen to have that on your desktop, we can always make it appear on your desktop, especially on some of these machines, where it may or may not have been kind of preloaded already. What you gotta do is just go to a nearby web browser and type in this magic URL. You say b4.autodesk.com/desktop. Chances are, I think we've done it with most of you, it's already installed on your machines and you won't have to do this, but just in case it isn't, you could always go back to that URL. It'll connect to the BIM 360 glue servers. It'll download a little launcher program that you then have to run. And theoretically, if you have access to installing software on your machine, it should be able to install it. I don't think this does anything very extraordinary that requires administrator privileges, so I think you're kind of okay. But let's go ahead and just have everyone open it up and see if you can get to this screen. Just the part that says BIM 360. And then Stanford BSI Glue. That's a host, which is really just a server that you have access to different projects on. And on that host, we have a series of different projects that are just kind of associated with different people's names. Since my naming scheme is so incredibly bad in terms of everyone always ending up in A or B, I tried adding you guys in this latest version under like Win 2016. Actually, I think right now that hasn't updated itself yet, so let me refresh that and go back down the list. Your list should be much kinder than mine just because you don't have so many different things. So there we are. We should all be kind of hanging around down there at the bottom somewhere. So 220B demo was where we were last time. That's where we sort of loaded some things and some of us worked on it together. You have some of your own kind of folders down there for uploading some of your own things. So again, how you can do that in terms of just getting started uploading things and starting to integrate it together is to go ahead and open up Revit on your machine. And let's sort of see if this is all working. I'm going to open up the Revit application. Okay. As part of Revit's installation, it installs a plugin which uploads things and lets you put them up to BIM 360 Glue. However, it always needs to update itself, so as the server software continues to change, it might need to change. How you can tell how you're doing in terms of the changes is go to the taskbar and look for the little Autodesk Application Manager. And say that you want to open it. Then once it's open, you can say, let us go ahead and update some software. And in this list, if you see something that says BIM 360 Glue, okay, for Autodesk Revit, there's BIM 360 Glue for Navisworks as well as for AutoCAD. So they may or may not be installed, but the one for Revit hopefully is installed. And if it is, we'll be able to take our Revit file and post it on up there to BIM 360 Glue, and you should be in good shape. Okay, so let's just go ahead and try that. So if you could just go ahead and open just whatever your state your architect your model is right now, and you can do it to your structural model if you have that, or your architectural model. Let's just sort of see if we can get the mechanics worked out. Go through and say, let us open up one of your files. I'm gonna go ahead, I'll open my ever so favorite Autobahn Center. Open the architectural file and we'll post that up. Then we can go ahead and post the structural file or the mechanical and kind of clash them together. So again, I'm gonna just open the Revit file. The idea within the Revit file is you need to go through and find a 3D view which includes everything you want to send up there. So this is using the same rules Navisworks works with. If you have visibility graphics or section boxed your settings so things aren't visible, they won't be uploaded. If they're visible, they will be uploaded. Okay. So what I'll often do is, even for this, go through and say, great, let me go through and create a default 3D view. Where'd it go? See if I could find where it created it over here in the list. This file has an awful lot of stuff in it. Hopefully yours doesn't have nearly as much stuff in it. I don't want the sheets. I don't want families. Not groups. I'm somewhere in the views. Chances are, I was going to suggest that it was over there. Let's go to 3D views. There it is. Lo and behold. Okay, I'm going to duplicate that view. And the reason I'm going to duplicate that view is I want to create something that is going to be so incredibly obvious to find that I don't have to go searching for it next time. So I'm going to try like dash dash export to BIM 360. And why am I doing that? I just want to make sure, hopefully as a little clue to myself, that I should always go to that view because it has the appropriate settings, the appropriate visibility. So, super. I've saved that away. Hopefully it shows up close to the top of the list. When I have that view, what I can do is say, let's go to add-ins. Let's go to glue. And go ahead and put this somewhere. So, you typically won't get asked about your host because you probably have one host you're associated with. You will then choose which project you want to put it in. I'm going to put it in the 2016 demo. We're going to have to give it a choice of really which view it is we want to export. I guess you can grab them all. But I'm going to go ahead and see. Oh, geez. Not a floor plan. Gotta somehow get myself better organized. I'm wondering if this is doing it in the order in which they're created. Looks like it is, because it's showing up at the bottom of the list. Okay, say next. That's the view I want to export. And now I can go through and give it a name. This name is really going to be just a convenience name. It's the name that's going to show up inside the BIM 360 glue system. It doesn't have to be the same as the name that we were using like in Revit. So I'm going to call this the architectural model. If I want to get really clever, I can say that it's the architectural model as of today. 602, is it the 12th today? 11th. The 11th. Okay. I can add it to a folder if I want to. That's kind of a useful thing sometimes, just to keep things organized so things aren't lying loose all over the place. If you want to add it to a folder, you can say that you want to choose to add to a folder, and I'll add a folder. under models. I'll say, great, this is the Audubon Center. Okay, I'm just stashing it away there. Dr. Hamamji.
Sorry to interrupt. If you update the actual Revit file, will the file be updated?
If you update the Revit file, say it.
Will the file upload and also upload?
Not automatically. Only as often as you re-glue the file.
How do you
glue? Oh, it's the same way we glue. We're just going to basically, when you get to a point that you want to put the new updated file up there, we go to this add-ins glue, and you say glue it.
Oh, okay.
It's like exporting it to an Avisworks file. So we'll just choose it. We'll say it's never been glued before.
Is there a version?
Yes, there actually is versioning. So if it comes from the same name and you glue it, it'll realize, oh, you're the same file. At which point it'll start to understand version 2, version 3, keep a little bit of history for you, which is kind of a useful thing. Okay, and it's good to sort of put things on top of the same name. In fact, maybe from that standpoint, it's better not to go ahead and put even the date in there. Because if I keep it by the same name and I take care of the versioning, the nice part is if I've run a lot of clash tests, they will continue to persist. They'll be there relative to that file. So if I make some changes that remove some clashes, it'll automatically be updated, and I don't have to recreate those clashes. So it's probably better to do it that way. So I'll say glue it. When you glue, it does the Navisworks thing. It's just a general comment. If you have Navisworks installed, it'll give you the choice of DWF or NWC, two different file formats. NWC tends to carry a little more useful information. DWF will work fine too. They both sort of do very similar things. Okay. It's going to go through and upload it. We'll let you know when it's complete. Okay, so that's up there. The architectural model is kind of hanging out over there. So, super. And similarly, you should do the same sort of thing if you have a secondary model, if you have a structural model, and you want to see them together, do the same thing for that model. Okay, the idea is we're trying to get all the models up there. So I'll do the same thing over on this model. I'll close up my architectural. Open this up. I'll open up the structural model. I realized after I said don't save, I probably should have saved to save that view. But here's my structural model. So again, what I can do is, oh, I've put it up there. In fact, well, let's just put it up there. We'll make some changes, and then I'll put it up there again. So you sort of see. We'll say that we want to add ins. Glue it on up there. We're going to add a view. Choose that 3D model. Okay, super. I will glue that. Oop, I put it in the same folder. Keep myself organized. It's never been glued. Okay, so it's going ahead and gluing some things in the background. Again, you'll see it's uploading the structural model. Okay, we'll let you know when it's complete. Okay, now in a few minutes, we'll go through and upload an updated version of that. Okay, so I've been uploading these two different models. Let's check on your end. On your end, have you been able to upload anything? Excellent, is it sort of working? Beautiful. Super, super, Gustavo, for you too. Excellent. Okay, if we're getting that part done, we're doing fine. Okay, looks like that's been successfully glued too. Super. Let's just go over and take a look at it briefly. If you want to look at this one that I've just uploaded, go ahead and open, it's Win 2016 220B demo or something like that. If you would prefer to look at the one that you've just uploaded, go ahead and open your file instead. In fact, maybe I'll just snoop around a little bit, since I like to do that. What do I have here? Looks like I haven't been updated recently. Let me refresh that. It looks like why Brittany has thrown up a couple different things for us.
Yeah, but it's not as, like, don't have to get that added because it's giving me a hard time.
Did it actually upload two things or? Oh, really? Now, this is interesting. Oh, so do you have trouble with the B? You're opening, like, you're having trouble getting to this. You were able to export it from.
I can do that.
Yes?
I get to that screen, and I dragged the files in, but then it told me something about not having.
Oh, no. Did you drag the files in, or did you glue them in?
Well, I tried
gluing
them in. I still can do that.
Ah, okay. So here's what happens. If you drag them in, then you can't really edit it. It just treats it like a file share. So it doesn't know what to do. So you have to go back to a Revit and try to drop them in that way. Okay, let's see what we got. Add a view.
Wait, so.
Oh, no, actually, go for the 3D. I want the 3D, not the structural part. Okay. Okay, let's go ahead and try gluing and see what happens. Ah, now this is the updating thing. So on this machine, it's not quite updated. If I could entice you into moving up front, Miss Alana has conveniently updated some of those machines. So that's all that's really going on. It's just a good updating thing. Or actually, even if you want to try and do it on this machine, let's go into the task manager down here.
Awesome.
We'll say
thanks.
Open that guy. Like Sanjay, when you tried to do this the other day, it worked, right? You were able to update the add-in?
It's on my laptop.
On your machine?
Yeah.
I did try to.
You did do it? Okay. Sure. Let's scroll down here. It's BIM 360 glue add-in for Autodesk Revit. Try and install like that.
Something available.
If this works, okay, then you'll be able to do it on this machine too. Okay. Oh, I can tell, actually, that these are just the RVT files, so you drag them on in. Okay, because usually what I'm looking at is like DWFs or NWCs. So let's see what else I got in here. So Seng Chai, it looks like you have your structural model.
I've uploaded the architectural.
Is it there now, too?
Oh, I think you just need to refresh.
Okay, very good. Let's see what we have over here. So again, I'll go to the bottom.
I think I just uploaded.
There we are. Oh, excellent. Oh, Christine, you got yours too? Where are you? Okay, what do we have? Not just yet. Let's see.
Bottom left.
I saw your name. Let's see if it updated in the system. Okay, still not quite updated yet. Okay, so it's working on you. Let me open up Seng Chai for right now. So here's the deal. I got Seng Chai's model over here. You'll notice I have both an architectural and a structural model. I can explore them independently. So for example, if I want to go through and just look at the structural model, I could click on it here. It'll open it in this viewing environment. The nice thing about this viewing environment is the viewing actually works in even a Chrome browser, which is really kind of nice because people have Chrome. They don't necessarily have Revit or Navisworks installed. Okay, so let me just expand this out a little bit. So here we have, here's the structure. Kind of hanging around under there. So that's actually looking pretty good. We can go through and again, zoom in, we can orbit, we can annotate, we can do all sorts of different things in terms of trying to understand that structure. Or if we want to, we can sort of bring the architectural and the structure together and see how they're working with each other. And to do that, what I'll do is go back to the outer folder. And I have architectural and structural. I'll say make a new merged model. And then I'll just choose the architectural and the structural. And I give it a name. So arc and struct. And the interesting thing is we can both do this. So I'm creating it. It's going to show up as you can do the same thing. You can call it something different. You know, but the idea is this is collaborative, so we can both be creating things and working on the models at the same time. Okay, so if I come back over here now, here's my version. I think Seng Chai is going to create another one in just a moment. But if I open the combined model, the merge model, you'll sort of see both his structure and his architecture all sort of working together. Let's see if we can actually see this. There's this little model tab right here. So if I, for example, turn off the architectural, you can see the structure inside. I can turn off the structure if I want to. Or I can even go through and sort of turn on and off different features. So for example, I'm showing the architectural model now. If I just want to turn off things at the roof level, I could turn that off. Or on any individual level, like on level 2, I can turn off a specific category of things. So roofs on level 2. And so just sort of exploring it that way. Now, this whole notion of, this is in the full BIM environment, or BIM 360 Glue environment, I'm able to create merge models. If you don't have the B4 Autodesk desktop application installed, and you just open a link that gets sent to you in the email, it might just open a Google browser and show it to you. And that actually happened to us last quarter, like Gustavo, I remember you had that problem when we couldn't create a merge model. And the reason was we were looking in the Chrome browser, we weren't looking in the desktop. So if ever you get to that interface and you see models but you don't see a choice about merge, that just means, you know, we need to open the desktop application as opposed to the Chrome browser. The Chrome browser is quite cool. It even works on the Mac side. It's really quite interesting. Okay, so I got a nice looking merge model here. Based on this merge model, I could go through and start leading all sorts of different comments or saving viewpoints. So based upon whatever it is you want to share, I know there is some interesting aspect of this model that before the next check-in, you want to highlight because you're going to share it with Alana so she can see exactly what you mean about the model. So if there's a viewpoint that really has what you're interested in, definitely think about, that really bothers me with the grids. I'm going to see if I can turn that off. I think that's a background setting. Navigation, I always have to remember in here. Select, full screen, add a view, add a section. That sounds interesting, sectioning this thing. Navigation modes, let me find under settings. I never remember where this is. It's account settings, how about options? General, XYZ differences, 2D view, background, visibility, graphics systems, viewer cache, linear units. I want it to be somewhere up top. I don't see it. Camera. If anyone finds the whole issue about turning off the grids, I know it's hiding in here. I just don't see it as I'm looking for it right now. Just say something and I'll turn it off. Graphics system, high fidelity warning. It's hanging around here somewhere. Let me try right clicking on this. Nope. I'll figure it out in a minute. Yeah, it just bugs me. I don't like the way that looks. Okay. Let us go ahead, we can save these. Yes, Mr. Henry? Or Dr. Hamamji, excuse me, I've revealed your true name so people know on the internet know. Yes?
So we have two different models, structure and architecture.
Yes.
Architecture was done in Revit, structure maybe was done in Tekla. Does that still work?
It does if we can export it into this format. So we might have to bring it as an IFC through Revit or something. Like Navisworks is beautiful. Navisworks has all of these different things. You can pull things in from all these different formats. The same sort of importing engine is underneath this, but in terms of, I don't think there's directly a Tekla plugin. So it could be, if from Tekla you can export a DWF, that would work.
Oh, okay.
Okay, or for Tekla you can export an NWC.
Oh, okay, as long as you things convert to one of those two.
Yes. As long as you can get it in one of those two formats, it knows how to operate it on. So you might have to do a little secondhand Tekla through Revit and export it that way. But yeah, it's all the file format stuff. Okay, so quite intriguing. Okay, so I've got this view I wanted to share with Alana. I'm going to say, great. Okay, structural issue 1. If I just save it to the project, that is kind of A-OK. It's just hanging around the project. Next time when someone goes in, you'll see that as a markup or a view that's hanging around there. If I want to notify someone, I can go through and say, let's go through and tell someone, take a look at this view. Okay, and what's going to happen is that's going to send an email that'll show up in Sengchai's inbox, and now the link will show there that'll take him right to that. So even if he doesn't have it open, it'll open up BIM 360 and then open up this viewpoint. Okay, so let's see what else I got going out here. If I go on out to BIM 360 Glue again, let's see if Christine has some goodies out here for me. Now, it's still not showing me anything. Let's see if I got anything in there. Nope. Have you uploaded them yet?
Actually, what? Did I give you Christine.John at Stanford.edu?
Oh, yes.
Could I change that?
You most certainly may. Actually, I think it's hanging around back over here. Oh, I know. Now, some of them are, it's a little confusing on all the stuff. So let's go through and, oh, did I open it? Add a member. Who would you like to add?
C-J-U-N.
At?
Stanford.
Oh, that, now that one we know all about. No members have been added. Interesting. Oh, add there. Now send the invitation. Okay, see if you can give that a try. When you, I think
it already said glue, it glued already. So I'm figuring it's somewhere in.
Okay. We'll go ahead and figure out where it is. Anyone else have a project that looks interesting?
Glenn?
Yes.
Can you open mine? The two models didn't align, so the structure's sticking out?
No worries, let's take a look at that. So if I come in here and I say I'll go through the other interface. That may mean that we have to do a little working with the coordinate systems to kind of get them aligned to each other. That's okay, we can certainly do that. Let's go back over here. Here we are, let's do your little align or your model here. See if I can zoom on in there and see. Oh, in this case, it looks like they may be aligned, just slightly misrotated. Okay, and that actually sort of happens. It's weird about, we seem to pick up alignment very well when you change the orientation relative to Project North. Mm-hmm. Okay, it doesn't seem to pick that up. So I am betting that if we looked at this really carefully back in Revit, you'd find that it actually has the same center point. It's really just that it's rotated around that center point. So I think you have the same origin. You're just sort of offset in terms of like that rotation, which is like 30 degrees, I think it was, or something like that for your project. So what we're gonna do is go back into both the projects. I think we fixed it in architecture. We maybe didn't fix it inside structure. Open the structure project and rotate the true north. Okay, that same 30 degrees so they align with each other, and then you'll be okay. Okay, I think that'll actually make that work out for you. Okay, what else do we got going on out here? Let's see who else I have. Actually, let me show this before we kind of leave this integration stuff. This also works very well on other devices. This works on iPads. It works in the Chrome browser. Let me go ahead and just try and bring this up and see if I can make this work. Let me go to and say Air Server. Come back over here and see if I can actually have something work. If I say Air Server over here, just so you can sort of see my little device over here. See if I can get this to get on the Stanford network. Stanford Secure, Stanford Visitor. Not yet. I'm gonna figure out why I'm not seeing the Stanford network. Because in order to make this work, only because of this little air server thing, it says I just can't find that network. Well, maybe I won't do that with you. I got Stanford Secure, I got Stanford Visitor. I don't think it'll find it though. I can try that. Oh, there it is. Okay, never give up. Okay, beauty. Let me try this now. If I'm able to get onto our network here, I should be able to do something where I can connect the two things together. Here. Back over here. Where is the window? I'm looking for a window which I think is hiding underneath something. There it goes. Okay, so here we're actually looking at my iPad now, and in the same sense, we can go out and grab one of your projects. Let's go through and go to BIM 360 Glue. Doing a little logging in. What this is going to do is actually give people who have iPads the ability to go through and navigate around pretty fluidly, just with their iPad, either kind of pushing around with their fingers or even doing a little gyroscopic navigation through things. Okay, so we got a couple models out here. Let me go through. I'll demonstrate with another model, not the one that we're looking at right here, but one that I actually have just right on the iPad here. This is, for example, a big hospital model. What I'm doing is just doing a little pinching. If I go ahead and just kind of use a single finger, I can sort of orbit it up like that. I'll zoom on in a little bit. Okay. Or even, if I want to, I can use this little pad over on the left side and do my walking. I'm crashing through, get into the lobby, and then maybe look up in the lobby, look down in the lobby. So quite interesting to be able to kind of bring your models to people on the job site through something like this, as opposed to just bringing a lot of drawings. This also has this very nice feature if there's a button, you're looking at it right over here in the 12 o'clock position over the little navigation control. That actually turns on gyroscopic viewing. And if you hold that down with your finger, you can sort of navigate around like this, which is kind of cool. There's some other cool stuff in terms of virtual reality and augmented reality. We'll sort of play around a little bit later. But I just kind of like the fluidity that this starts to give you in terms of starting to think about sharing your models. In the same sense, if I wanted to go through and mark things up, I could go through and, you know, add something that I want to do, save it away, okay, and then that's now a markup that I can go ahead and return to. So depending upon what it is you're trying to show, you can go, I can kind of just embed these things, or even better, go through and mail that to someone, and then like kind of send them the markups. So in that same sense, let's see what you guys got out there. Who do I have? Christine, did you get anything uploaded yet? You think so? Okay, still not. Oh, there we got something. Woohoo! Okay, let's take a look. Yes. No, the viewers can't modify the model, only the people who publish the models can. So if you want Christine to make a change, you have to ask her to.
Can you change that setting?
In terms of allowing or not allowing?
Mm-hmm.
Nah, it's really, this is set up really as a viewing environment, not an editing environment. Yeah, so there's no way, like even in this environment, all I can do is sort of notice things, okay? Again, I can go through, put markups in, sort of say, hey, this is interesting.
So you have to change it in Revit, or you can change it in the viewer?
You have to go back to Revit.
Oh, Revit.
But let's try experiment with it. Okay, go over there, save that away. If I want to notify Christine about that, I can say notify. I'm going to send that to Christine. So she'll get a little link to that so she can go and take a look at it. But this is a good way of just kind of sharing things. Even if you have questions about your model and some sort of problem you're having between now and the next time we get together, try that. Just try like creating a link to it and send us a message, and that way we'll be able to see exactly what you're talking about in your model. Okay. So, yeah, it works very well in this sort of iPad interface. It works in the web interface. Again, if you want to go through and change things, let's go back and talk about that. What I'll do is, did I turn that off? Let me go and just turn off Air Server for right now. We'll go back over to Revit Land. If in Revit Land, if I can find Revit Land, I decided I want to go through and make some changes to this. For whatever reason, I decide, okay, I'm going to do some sort of different framing system over here out on the kind of piers that are on the outside. I'm going to go through and put in some sort of like a wall footing there instead. Is that a wall? Let's see. It may not be a wall. I'll just go ahead and post it like this. Okay, so I'm going to go through, or even in this one here, let me change it to, turns out it's going to be a much bigger pile right there instead. Okay, if I want to go through and change these and post them, what I'll do is I'll say add-ins, I'll glue it again. What it's going to realize is, hey, okay, you glued this already. I can tell it was last glued over here. So if you want to glue it again, what you can do is do that, and now it's going to have two different versions. It's going to have the updated version and the old version around. And it's nice because you can go back and re-intersect. You can re-merge old versions or new versions. So you can sort of keep a little running history of how your progress is going. So, quite okay. Would you like to update this model with a new version or save it as a new model? I'm going to update the model. So it gives you the choice about whether it's going to be a new version of the old or just saved as a brand new model. Again, the advantage of being an updated version of the old is that your clash detections, your markups, your viewpoints will all be saved as part of that merge model. So let's pause there for a second. That's all I want to get going with, like in terms of BIM integration. For the most part, just go ahead and play with getting all the software links hooked up and all the add-ins working. If they're all working, it'll tend to work pretty fluidly for you, okay? But it's a great way of being able to sort of just see how well those different systems are working together. Something happens when you try walking through your model. You often see things that you don't see in any other perspective, and you'll start to realize, why do I have that beam there? There's all these little things that happen. So go ahead and try that. It's a good way of immersing yourself. Okay, we'll play more with the augmented reality stuff later. So any questions about that? Generally good? Just give it a try. Give it a try. Oh, I should have commented in lots more times available. So if you haven't yet signed up for a time for getting together with us sometime this week, go ahead and please take a look at that. What do I have out there on the calendar? It looks like, if we go to the week's agenda, what do we have here? We have someone coming in this afternoon. Ryan's gonna check in from remotely. We have someone, Jacqueline is coming tomorrow. Many of you aren't on that list yet, so if you wanted to be on that list, go ahead and sign up. Yes?
So I accidentally signed up for last week.
Yes.
And I met Angad in the hallway, and he said 4:30 is fine.
Oh, so today?
Okay.
Oh, that should be fine for me. Okay, so just...
You're meeting him at 5, so I
yeah.
It's a good...
So just, we'll meet you down there at 4:30? That sounds super.
156 or 184?
Usually 184.
Oh, wait.
Oh, no, it's happening.
Class is that? Yeah.
So we'll have to be down 159.
159?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. That's going to work for you with Ram's class?
I'll just skip a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sounds good. Okay. Anyone who has not seen us to talk about the structural stuff, we're all kind of at different points, but in general, you want to have a fairly kind of a well-defined external envelope and the beginning of the structural system in place. If you haven't seen us yet, please check in. Because somehow, between all these different times that are available, we ought to be able to find one. If you want to see what's available, what's going on? Next week. Still many times available tomorrow, as well as, I don't know, we could add some on Tuesday or something like that. But yeah, that is, I'll check in with us at least once a week. Alana likes it. It makes us feel good. What's going on? Just help you along. So like, yeah, that'll work. Okay, let us then shift our gears just a little bit. Okay, what I want to talk about next is really the structural analysis part of all this. So if you can, let's go ahead and shift our attention over to that side of the equation. When it comes time to do structural analysis, the big thing is you got to have a model that'll really, you know, hold water, or in our case, hold loads. We have to have water that's sort of set up, or a model that's sort of set up. So you have probably put in some structural floors, some structural walls. You've probably done that already. Today we'll go ahead and add in some loads and some boundary conditions, things that'll actually resist. So loads that'll actually be on the structure, as well as some boundary conditions that will resist those loads. And then we're going to take it off to some analysis tools. And in terms of analysis tools, there are many available to you. There are some Revit plugins. The Revit plugins include the Structural Analysis Toolkit. The Structural Analysis Toolkit lets you do a couple different things. You can either analyze your model in the cloud, which is kind of quick, but it gives you less control, or you can export it directly to something like Robot Structural Analysis, which gives you an awful lot of direct control, but has a lot more complexity to it. Okay? There's also a great plugin called the CXI X Revit Connector. If you're familiar with ETABS, if you're a structure student here at Stanford and you use ETABS in your classes, we can go ahead and take your model and use ETABS instead. I tend to use Robot Structural just because I'm more familiar with that, but ETABS, it's really very equivalent once you export it. It's really just whichever system you're more familiar with. Okay, you could take it over to SAP, you could take it over to all sorts of different systems depending upon what you're familiar with. Once we export these systems, we can either analyze them in the ETABS software or the Robot Structural software. Robot Structural is installed on, I think, all these machines and the ones that are down in the 184 cluster. ETABS, if you want to install that, you're going to have to put it on your own machine. Well, actually, it's on some of the machines, but a lot of people just install it on their own machines. Okay. And as we're doing our analysis, a big important thing to kind of be aware of right up front is think about the scope of what you're analyzing. You could analyze the entire structure, but that may be more complex than you really want to take on. So what I'm going to highly advocate is that we find a subset of your structure and just really try to isolate some beams, some columns, and some boundary conditions so that you can just look at a single frame or two, not too much. Otherwise, it just sort of gets very complex. Okay. For the software, there's a couple of things you need to know. In terms of getting these plugins, if you want to get the structural analysis toolkit, you can download it in a couple different places. You can, if you want to, just go over to Canvas. And if you go to our class and say, I would like to go through and look at the files, under software installs, let me not move that, you'll find the structural analysis toolkit plugin for Revit 2016 here right next to the lighting analysis plugin. So you can download that and put that on your machine. What that'll do is back over in Revit, if I can find Revit, it'll put in under the Analyze tab some choices under structural analysis. You'll see robot structural analysis link, reinforcement code check, as well as analyze in the cloud. Okay, so if you've installed that, you can. The other place you can get this, you can always get the plugins out there just on the web. There's this place called AppExchange. Autodesk. AppExchange, what's that? Is it apps.autodesk.com? Same place. Okay. If you go through and you say structural, you'll find the structural analysis toolkit, including the one for 2016. So get it either place. Either download it from our site or you can go out and get it there. You'll find a lot of interesting plugins out here. So this is actually a good place to look. This is a place where people who write plugins might eventually publish them and make them available to other people to either license or buy or subscribe to. So this is like where all that stuff ends up, is out here. Okay, if you want the CSI Revit thing, that's actually a little, yeah, because you're working with, does anyone work with eTabs? I should ask. Does anyone? Aha! There's one in every crowd. And here's how you find the information if you want to work with and install eTabs. That is a commercial software solution, but we have a license available to Stanford students. So if you go out to Bimtopia, you will find out there under Global AEC, which is Renata's class where a lot of people use eTabs, some instructions on how to install eTabs on your computer as well as how to share the Revit models. So if you just go down and follow that series of links, there's a place for you to download eTabs, a place to connect to our license server, which is over in the Bloom Center, as well as a link to go through and install the connector. The eTabs is here. The connector is under sharing the local files. If you are going to work with eTabs, though, and you're going to work on your own machine, you just have to be on the Stanford network. Okay, so if you're outside of the Stanford network, you have to connect with a VPN, because the typical public connection kind of cuts that off. Okay, and if that makes sense to you, I'm not going to worry, because that's actually, yeah, it's kind of a little bit of messiness with all the license servers if you're working off campus. Okay, so either place you can go out and grab some software. If you want to just download Robot Structural to put it on your own machine, eTabs, the instructions were on Bimtopia. For Robot Structural, if you go to students.autodesk.com and you say you would like to get some free software, it doesn't show up at the top of the list, but it'll show up if you say all products. And you'll find Robot Structural Analysis right there. So using your Autodesk ID, your student account, you can download that, install it for free. You'll get serial number, license code, all that type of stuff. If anyone has the machine here and wants to just copy it off of a thumb drive so that you don't have to download it, okay, we have it up here. Okay, so if you want that, please feel free to do that. Okay, so enough of all the prep. Let's go ahead and actually talk about putting some files together, loading up some files. And to do that, if you can, we're going to go into Revit, and we're going to open up. It's a file that I actually put into, I think it was yesterday's folder, but it might actually have been the day before. But let's go into Revit and see if we can find it. Go into Revit and say that you would like to open, and in, where is it? I think it's under session 9. Nope. It is under session 11. I did move it. You go to session 11 and you download structural analysis examples, you will find some Revit models of some interesting structures. It's basically the same little structure. One's made out of steel and one's made out of concrete. So go ahead and download and we'll start with the steel one. Just open it on up. You'll find the simplest structure you can imagine. Well, you might be able to imagine a simpler one, but it's pretty straightforward. Okay, this is the model we have in mind. Let me kind of show it to you back in 3D, then we'll talk about this analytical model. That's what it looks like in 3D. Not too awfully bad. I could shade it if I want to. This is a simple little, essentially one by one system. Okay, this is an example, or working with something like this is an example of something I call the Hamamji principle, and named after someone who happens to be here with us today. It is based on the notion that before you go ahead and try to really dig into the complexity of using a tool on a complex structure, see if you can master it on a very simple structure and get consistent, reliable, repeatable results that agree with your intuition. If you can get that to work, then we'll scale up. But always scale back to the real core of it and see if you can get it to work. Okay, and I learned that principle the hard way from someone who shall be named within. Okay, so we have a very basic little structure here. Let's go ahead and take a look at it. This is the structural model, the way it might look to the outside world. Like if you're looking at it spatially, it looks like this. If I want to think about it more analytically, that is the way a structural analysis kind of engineer might want to go through and look at it, switch over to the analytical model view, and it'll look more like this. And let us talk about what we see here. This model, which was created in the structural modeling template, has a couple of really interesting features to it that we need to know about. We have down here at the base of the columns these things called boundary conditions. And what are boundary conditions? They are the things that resist. When you put thousands of pounds of pressure pushing down on the ground, if we just sort of don't resist that, things will move. And the structure will deflect and the ground might fail. There's all these things that might happen. A boundary condition is really just, it's something that you're gonna say is fixed. You know, from that point, we're not gonna let you go any further in that direction. And that resistance is actually the ability, or gives us the ability to do the structural analysis, because it creates the reaction. So you'll see there are a couple of boundary conditions on there. Now, as you get going with your model, you may not have some boundary conditions in there yet. You probably look more like this to get started. You just have some columns coming on, and there's no boundary conditions there. So what we need to do is add in some boundary conditions. And to do that, you go under Analyze. You'll find boundary conditions in loads and load cases. Under boundary conditions, you'll find a couple different choices. A fixed condition, a pin condition, a roller condition, or a user condition where you can sort of choose some combination of those forces. Okay, so as I'm going through and trying to support this structure, it actually does make a difference. If I think those are all fixed conditions, truly fixed, they're not only resisting kind of motion sideways or motion up and down, they're also resisting moments, okay, then those columns will be assumed to carry a little bit of moment, okay, and that'll affect the way the forces are carried a little bit because, you know, they'll sort of resist a little bit. You can, if you want to, for simplicity, assume that the connections are fixed. It's probably not the most accurate assumption, but if I do choose fixed, I can go clicking on those and put four of those there. It might be a little bit more accurate, honestly, to go through and think about those columns, or at least many of them, as being fixed, or excuse me, pinned columns. Pinned columns would be a little bit different. If I go through and pin the columns, or pin the bases, I'll change that to pinned instead. It's not going to go through and boundary conditions on a point. It's not going to go through and resist the rotation. It is going to go ahead and resist x and y, and it's not going to let it go straight down in z, but it's not going to resist the rotation. So if I do go through and pin my columns, then I have to make sure that I either add some braces to it so that I have resistance for the lateral loads, or I have to go through and kind of make one of the frames a moment frame so that it'll resist it that way. For the purposes of what we're doing, just to kind of keep it simple, I probably would just go ahead and fix them. At least to get started, because it gets a little more complicated if we consider it other ways. It won't be 100% accurate, but it'll be close. Okay, so we have the structure. It has these four different boundary conditions. If you have started in another template and you didn't start in the structural template, not to worry, you just need to copy these boundary conditions in. So if you started in the architectural template, and you go looking for these boundary conditions, it'll say, hey, there aren't any right now. And the reason is they just haven't been loaded in. What you'll need to do is go through and do a little inserting. Turns out boundary conditions are an object. So I can grab those different objects. Okay, you'd think you'd be done by now, but you're not quite. You still have to do one more thing. You have to get them in there. The other thing you have to do, though, if you aren't started working with a different template, is you have to just sort of set up which boundary condition applies to which case. So when we choose boundary conditions, fixed will be mapped to the fixed object, pinned will be pinned, roller will be roller, and user defined will be variable. And if you do those two things, load them in and you associate them, then you're back in the same case as though you started the structural template. So, you know, if you started in architectural and you need to sort of move them in, that's what you need to do. You just need to kind of move those in so you have boundary conditions available. Okay, but hopefully that won't apply to you. You'll have some nice boundary conditions. The other thing we're going to think about is loads. And in terms of loads, loads can be modeled as Revit objects too. We have, if you look at this structure, it looks like some sort of load that's applied to this floor. Check it out. This is an area load. This is an area load of, it's currently set to minus 0.05 kips per square foot. Okay, that's 50 pounds per square foot pointing down. And that's kind of reasonable as a live load. We can go ahead and kind of change it if we want to, in terms of, we could change the size of it. If I want it to be 100 pounds per square foot, I could do that. Notice it gets a little bit bigger. I could also go through and apply more than one load. If you know that you have a specific load in a specific place, you can go through and apply a load. Oh, under loads, we have the choice of either a point load, if you have a specific load coming down in a very targeted area, you know, typically from a column that's putting a lot of weight in a specific place. I could apply that. So for example, I could take a point load. Let me even sort of say a hosted point load, because then I can put it on top of a beam. But yeah, Henry, what you got?
Is that like HVAC equipment?
See it?
Is that HVAC equipment point load?
One more time.
Like MEP equipment?
Oh.
Is that a point load?
Yeah, that would typically be if an unusual load, you know, specifically heavy, you know, like a 2,000 pound sort of air handler or something like that. Yeah, that's a point load. Well, or you could make it an area load if it's 2,000 pounds spread over a 5x5 area. Okay, that might be a reasonable way to do it too. If I wanted to do that, what I could do is say, let's go ahead and do a load. I'll do an area load. Okay, I'm gonna go through and, I'll just draw an area load. Okay, let's check it out. Now, that's actually down on the lower level. That's not where I want it to be. I should have actually reset my work plane to be level 2. Okay, but no worries, we'll fix that. Can look like I can do it there. I'll try this. Let's do a little move action to it. Oh no, it looks like it's actually, it won't let me move it because it's there. Okay, no worries. We'll do it on level 2 again. I'll say we'll go through and put our load in. This should be at level 2, but just to make certain, let me set my work plane to be level 2. Just to, okay, it is at level 2. That's good. Okay, area load. Take a look at that. Now the magnitude of that load, again, can be set by choosing the load. This is going to be considered a dead load now, which is probably a fair thing for a piece of equipment like that, as opposed to a live load. The magnitude could be whatever it's going to be per square foot, so maybe 100 per square foot. Super. And what we're going to start having is different combinations of loads that need to be considered differently, kind of based on the structural code. As we go through and think about doing our structural analysis, what tends to happen is we don't just consider a single load case, just the live load and the dead load. We look at different prescribed combinations of live and dead loads together with different weightings and factors to try and figure out which case is the worst case or the the dominating case, the case that's really sort of determining how the requirements will be set. So we can apply different loads in here. Now, in terms of loads, a small distinction I want to make over here is there's point load, line load, and area load, which are drawn loads, so you got to put them on whatever plane they need to be on, level 1 or level 2, and you can draw them arbitrarily, whatever you want them to be. There's hosted loads, hosted point loads, hosted line loads, and hosted area loads. Those are very useful. For example, if you have a whole floor plate and you want to say that that floor plate, regardless of the size it might get to, is always going to have that load, you can host it on that and then it'll use the boundary of the floor plate and assume and kind of apply the load all over the whole thing. So that's how that one is done. So let me kind of show you what's necessary though to do that, because this is something you may get into in your model. I'm going to take that load off. There's actually a floor on here. I guess it's right there. I'm looking at it. I'm not even seeing it. Okay. It's right there. Okay. So a little lightweight concrete with metal deck. Watch out for this. If when you put that there, and you might have done it in the architectural model, structural wasn't turned on. If you try to put loads on it, a hosted area load, it won't go. It doesn't stick. Because if the floor is not considered to be a structural element, it won't accept the loads. Okay. So if you ever try to stick things down on something and it just won't take them, kind of watch out for the whole issue. Is it a structural element? If it is a structural element, then it is known as being a recipient for the loads. You can drop it on there, and then you're okay. Okay, so watch out for that one. Okay, the other funny little loading thing I will warn you about, and it's just the silliest thing, and I'm not sure exactly why it's true. I could think about like reasons you could sort of justify it, is if you start putting roofs on your buildings, you notice roofs don't have the ability to be structural. There's no structural checkbox on the roofs. Kind of weird, okay? If you want to go through and put loads on your roof, you can model your roof as a flat roof, as a floor. That would work just fine in terms of doing that. That's okay. And often if you have a flat roof, I recommend doing that. Just put it on as a floor, because then And there's really not much difference structurally, you know, for the purpose of modeling that, that works out okay. But another way I want to kind of just make you aware of that you can do it is this. I'm just going to copy these things up. Oops. Looks like I need a level 3 to make that work. Hang on, just for the purpose of this demo. Do another 10 feet. Okay, super. Now I got level 3. Go back to 3D. Again, I'm going to do boom, boom, boom. Copy all those and paste them up to level 3. Okay. If you could imagine that being my roof beam as opposed to floor beam right now, I can even slope it if I want to in terms of making it a little bit taller. But if I want to go through and apply a load to that, what I recommend as a workaround is taking the loads, let's analyze, and just apply a hosted line load. Now let's think about the difference between a hosted line load and hosted area load. If you have 100 pounds per square foot and there's 10 feet between the beams, okay, just think about the tributary area between the beams and multiply that. So instead of being 100 pounds per square foot, that's going to be 50 pounds per lineal feet. Is that right? No, 500, excuse me. Got to multiply it the right way because I just need to sort of take the tributary area. So I can now apply this as a line load there and make it 500. Okay, just something to think ahead as you kind of start thinking about if you're going to do for the purpose of analysis your roof. Don't worry about the fact that the roof won't actually carry the loads. Just apply some line loads at the few places that we're actually going to look at the analysis. Okay, then it'll sort of work. Henry.
So the curtain wall is hanging from the beam or slab?
Ah, in that case, you could apply it to the beam. Yeah, you could do it as a line load. If you want to model the weight of the curtain wall, I would just hang it on the beam.
Is it just like density of glass times the area times the thickness?
We'd come up, and there's also the mullions. We'd have to come up with some approximation for, you know, how many pounds per square foot, and then multiply it by the floor-to-floor height, and just hang it as the linear feet. Yeah, that's reasonable. And then that'd be a dead load. Yeah. Yes, Christine, good job.
So when you were mentioning turning a roof into a floor so that you can have some load on that, do you recommend doing, is there ever a case where it makes sense to do roof and then just do a wall, or and then a floor on top of that?
Oh, that would work, or it's interesting, yes. For the purpose of our structural model, you know, because all we're really trying to do here is really create a host for the structural loads. So yeah, you can create a floors, put it right on top of the roof. You wouldn't show it ever, except as a host for these structural loads. And kind of a cool thing, I didn't think about this, because you have those sloping roofs that kind of work that way.
Yeah.
If, for example, let's going to do this. I'll put a roof on here, then we'll do it kind of the way you want it. We'll say, let's say roof by footprint. I'll put it at level 2. Hang on. So if I went through and did this and I said, great, it has a 1 foot overhang, the whole 9 yards. Let me get a level 2. Let's see if it'll let me do it. Choose some walls. Actually, well, it's going to just do it on that. Okay. I don't have any walls. I only have beams in this thing. Okay. And, in this model, that was a slope, whatever. Roof not showing. Okay, so there's your roof. So, if you actually want to model out of the floor, for example, what you could do is actually do this. This is what I'll do sometimes. There's no easy way just to make a roof into a floor, right? That doesn't quite work. What you can do is say, edit the footprint, grab the pink line boundary, okay, copy that, close it up again. Then I'll say, let's do a floor by footprint. Okay. I'll paste in the boundary. I'll just paste it exactly to the same place. Oh, come on, line in the same place. We'll do it here. Beautiful. Okay, that'll actually make the floor. An interesting thing about floors, okay, we'll make it structural because I want it to accept the loads, is floors have this ability. They actually have, this is kind of strange, one side can define a slope. So if you actually have like a shed roof, kind of like you do, you can actually choose one side to be a slope, and then the floor can come up at the same level. And then we can do the same 30 degrees or whatever it is. So what I can do is, I guess what I'm trying to show is that, you know, there's a way to fairly easily go through and what happened? Oh, there's the floor right there. It's sloping down right now. Da, 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 da. I want to see about how to do that. Okay, so now I actually have a floor and a roof that are on the same place. So I can model that and then use that as my host. That would actually work. Yeah. Yeah, sort of a trade-off about whether I think it's worth it. So I might just go for putting the beams in and just modeling those and do it that way. But I'd go either way on that. Okay, let's pause there for a second. General questions, or does the whole idea of putting these loads on this kind of make sense? More or less? Henry's, he's giving it a, I'm not quite sure, but I'm willing to entertain this kind of look. How about you, Gustavo? Feel good?
How do you determine the loads?
Ah, very good question. Usually it's sort of determined either by code requirements. For example, typically the live load in most buildings will be considered to be like 50 pounds a square foot. I can actually give you a table that has some of these things. Generally it's 50 pounds a square foot throughout. If you're down on a corridor, it's considered to be a little bit heavier. If it's on a first floor corridor, it's typically 100 pounds a square foot just in that area. So what I'll sometimes do is to put the 50 all over, then put another 50 just in the corridor area. I think on the upper floors, it might be 80, it might be 60. It's a smaller number. There's this presumption that your first floor corridor, you may be wheeling big heavy things through, but second and third floor, maybe not as much. Okay, so 50 is kind of generally it. There's specific loads for different things. If you do a balcony or a like terrace, I think that's now, is it 60 or it might be higher? The code's just changed on this. Because, you know, often a lot of people cluster together out on balconies and terraces, much denser than in a typical kind of classroom setting or something like that. If it was a library, you know, you kind of think about, in the code we'll find specific load recommendations for each area. The other type of load, that's live loads. Dead loads, think about it this way. For the dead loads, typically the structural members themselves, okay, you won't even know how heavy they are until you start doing the calculations. So you don't need to go through and try to estimate those. The structural analysis software will take care of that themselves. So the self-weight of the structure is usually taken care of by the structural analysis software. Okay. The other loads though, oh, you put some tile floor, a marble kind of tile surface, or things like that, then you'll tend to estimate that as a surcharge on top of it. So think of dead loads beyond the structural loads you have to add in. Okay, but there aren't that many. It's typically like just floor finishes and things like that. Okay, but that'll start. I'll find you a table that has exactly like, there's some very specific code recommendations. That these are the types of loads you need to consider. Although Henry asked a really good question about, for example, unusual piece of mechanical equipment that's going to be located on the roof or something. If you know you have a load of 10,000 pounds or something like that, you just drop that in a specific place where you know it's going to be. Okay, so I've got my loads in here. I got my boundary conditions. Again, I can look at my analytical model just to make sure things are looking good. I guess I was originally calling that a live load. Okay, we are ready to start doing some analyzing. Okay, before you go off and do your analyzing, there's just a couple things you, or one last thing you might want to check. There's this whole notion of really whether, okay, this thing is really supported and whether it's consistent right now. These are some things you can do in Revit just before you even send it to the analysis, just to make sure that things are connected and not kind of hanging loose and that everything seems to have a support to it. So a little pre-flight check. So you can say, let's check the supports. Okay, and it told me down here, member support check complete, no unsupported elements detected. Okay, so it didn't see anything that was flying completely loose. As far as it could tell, everything eventually traced down to some sort of a boundary condition. Okay, the other one is consistency checking here. Looks like it thinks it's all consistent. This is actually one where, you know, even Henry, we talked about the whole notion of having a smarter plugin. I could do some pre-flight checking to, I think what this is doing is very, very basic, just are you even physically connected, to go back and try to apply a little more intelligence to see whether the type of connection really makes sense. Okay, so this is where you'd sort of slot that into the workflow. Okay, but enough of all that. Do you all have this model kind of sitting up on your screen? Okay, if you do, you are ready to go ahead and start doing some analysis, and here's how we're gonna do it. Robot Structural, another package which is going to run in the background. Sometimes when you open it up, it puts up a dialog that says, okay, accept, I agree to let you use all my personal data for life. And you know, you have to go ahead and accept that. So what I recommend doing is, just because it'll sometimes open that in the background and just confuse things, is to open up Robot Structural and just have it kind of open in the background. So on your machines, at least in the first row especially, Robot Structural should be there. If it's not on your machine, I think Lonnie even said it's in the second row too. So see if you find Robot Structural Analysis. And it could be 2016 or 2013. Well, that's interesting. A license error has occurred due to a change in your date and time settings. Okay, activate the license. Super. Looks like something that would happen when I changed into Windows 10. Okay, so see if you can get it open in the background. So the idea is, typically when we're gonna do analysis, we go through and we create these great line models and we build them in eTabs or we build them in other tools. But the idea is that since you've already gone through and created this, kind of hanging out over in Revit, you shouldn't have to do that again. Close the wrong one. Okay, because that line model that you're looking at right there is very, very similar to what eTabs or a Robot Structural wants. And if we want to transfer that over to the analysis software so we can operate on it, we can go through and say Robot Structural Analysis and choose the Robot Structural Analysis link. And if you choose that, it'll back end work for you right now. Here you have the choice of, do you want to send the model? That's sending it over to Robot. Update the model says you've made some changes in Robot. You want to bring them back and kind of update the BIM model. Direct integration, I think, is a great way to do it. Under send options, there's an interesting choice. We'll use this for your structures. There's the whole choice of whether we only want to send the current selection or send the entire project. So for this simple project, we'll just send the entire project. But when we go through and do it on yours, we'll just sort of select a few, you know, bays and send that instead. So say okay to that. We are ready to go. Let's let it do a little exporting. Again, the algorithm it's going to use here, it's going to send that line model out. It's going to send the information about the members that we've already selected over here, over there. We're going to kind of size things up, just kind of check to see if those members are adequate. And if we're not adequate, we're going to go through and just change the members over in Robot Structural with the idea that we'll keep on working over there until it looks good and then send it back again. So a little iterative cycle. By doing this, you theoretically are going to have the ability to kind of like make some initial assumptions, verify, and then iterate. So let's say this. You know, everyone try that. Let's see if you can get this far. Are you seeing something that looks like it was successful? Or what's happening? Jack, well, I can tell by that look, something's not quite right. It's still downloading. It's still downloading? What's happening?
No, it's still
working? Oh, You can probably cancel that. How about fusing, Jerry? Is it, well, you, it's on your machine.
It's the same thing.
It's configuring.
Yeah.
Interesting. Anyone doing anything, or what do you got?
Configuring.
That's annoying. What happens if you cancel? That's because what it's trying to do is it's trying to go through and update the Revit installation a little bit. Yes. Let's see what's going on. Try even canceling that one. Because it shouldn't actually have to. And again. That seems like we may just have to go through and do it as a run through one so that all the different software is installed, not available. What it's trying to do is update robot structural analysis to update Revit to go ahead and do this.
So I didn't update it before.
Yeah.
And I did so.
See you guys later. Great. Can I just cancel out of that for now?
Yeah, I did cancel it.
No worries. On these machines here in our room, maybe kind of looking a little flickly. Oh, check it out. If you just keep on canceling, evidently, Brittany got it. That's not too bad. Okay. Let's see. So evidently, it does work.
Just prompt you like 20 times a
day. I'm not canceling and anything will work. Let's go ahead. We're just seeing if we can get it to work for Sanctuary 2.
And then it's like continuing.
Yeah. That's annoying. What we have to do with all these machines is just kind of rerun the installation. I think that it's just never been run before. Okay. Sanchai's going to be very surprised when he comes back and he's actually It'll just check to see if it's physically connected, but it won't actually go further, you know, in terms of doing what you want to do. Okay. So let's go ahead and we'll just keep on going. So I'll give you that last little bit and then we'll continue next time. He's looking at it in a funny spot. I just want to see something over here. I can hear if I can get it to him just in case he comes back. And Gustavo, you're working on your own, right?
Yeah, I got something, but I'll wait to see what it is.
That's always a good strategy. One's never quite sure. We have to do all the cancels. It definitely makes a big old mess out of it. That's why it's better to install on your own. Oh, actually got one for him. Enough. I don't cancel it. Actually, for the next step, if Sanjay doesn't come, oh, he's come back. Oh, he can't come back. Oh, poor St. John.
He's locked out at the end.
That's not good.
Okay. We canceled enough and eventually it came through.
Okay, cool.
So let's see. We won't see the events report. We'll just go over and take a look. Let's just talk at a high level about what it's going to do. I'll give you the real quickie and then we'll continue it next time. But here's what's going to happen. Oh, don't do that to me. Da, 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 da. I was hoping for a nice 3D view. This is always messy. I wish I knew this better. If I say that I want to do it in 3D. I'm bad about this. Okay, I'm going to export it again. When it pops up in the 2D view, it sort of mystifies me. And I just need to learn robot structural better so I can avoid having to be mystified by that. That looks better. So what you're looking at here is actually the line model sitting around in robot structural. At a high level, you see the grid lines and the level lines hanging around in there. You'll also see if you go, there's these little widgets at the bottom. You can go through and turn on like node numbers. Every node, every point has a number, which is useful for identifying borrowers and members when we're analyzing them. The second one actually shows the bar numbers as opposed to the node numbers. So every bar has a number. The third one actually shows the floor slabs and what it's made out of. Fourth one down there shows, it should show the loads. There's the boundary conditions, either turning them on or turning off. Fifth one actually shows the section shapes. That's the actual physical shape of everything. So I can zoom on in. I don't have my mouse with me today. So it looks like that's panning. Oh, that was weird. What do I want to do? I want to steal someone's mouse. You can't steal a mouse in here, they're all glued down.
I got one.
You got one? I'm going to find what I did with mine in a second. Thank you, sir. Oh, and that's got the, oh, check it out, the dongle and everything. You are a lifesaver, as they say. I feel so much better now. That's good. Thank you. I'm going to find that mouse. Okay, there's the section shapes. If I go through and choose the next one, what's going to happen? That actually is going to show the slab or not. It's a little hard to see what's going on there. Next to it is basically, oh, which loads I have on there now. It looks like actually this is dead load case one. I don't have anything there. Let me switch over to live load one, and you'll see I do have a load there. So I have different load cases that are being considered, and you can sort of show the loads or not. Finally, I have, that's the magnitude of the loads. And last but not least, this is whether or not to show the finite elements, but we're gonna leave that turned off for right now. So at some level, this is just showing us the same information that was over in the Revit model. But here's what we're gonna do. Based upon what we have so far, we would like to sort of say, okay, we made some pretty wild assumptions about how big these beams could be. Let's go ahead and check to see if they're even close to being adequate. And here's how you can do that. You can go through and, if you go to analyze or analysis, say that you would like to do some calculations. I think it's the calculations. It might be prepare results. I always have to remember. I'm going to prepare. No, that's prepare results down there. Let's go back and I will say analysis, calculations. And it'll go through and do some calculations for us. Now, in that first round, when we say let's just go through and do some calculations, it's really just an advanced calculator. It isn't doing much more than, you know how to do these beam equations. You've done them painfully, slowly drawing them all out. So for any of these different beams, we could go through and look at a shear diagram, a bending moment diagram, a diagram of the deflection. But given the existing assumptions and these load cases, basically, how are we doing? Shear and bending moment, those will sort of be based on the loads and the geometry. Deflection would involve more of the actual member that got put in there too. But let's take a look. We will go through and do this. We will say that we would like to see some results, and in terms of results, we can put some diagrams on the bars or maps on the bars. Let's try diagrams on the bars. We have the choice of, for example, choosing some either forces, moments, or we'll look at deflections in a second. For example, let's go ahead and take a look at the forces. And I'm very bad about which direction's which. That's the forces in the Z direction. Okay, that you might sort of recognize as, well, just forces up and down. That actually sort of makes sense. That's like the shear diagram is probably the best way to describe that. So if you look over here and you're looking at that diagram over there, that's the shear. Okay. You can also, within this, go through and under the very last tab, I think it's parameters, put labels on these things. At which point it'll give you just a little graphical information. You can sort of see it's showing for all the different bars. So we have the shear diagrams for the intermediate beams as well as for the big beams on the ends. That's looking okay. If you prefer, you could also go back and show the bending moments. In the bending moments, this is the one that always sort of gets me in terms of what direction it is. I think it's MY. Okay. And you can sort of see, oh, here's some bending moments. You'll see that on the big beam across the front, it's currently 34.82, 11.74 over here. You can sort of see different bending moments on different members. Okay. You might be thinking, hey, these shear and bending moment diagrams are pretty groovy, but you know, how is the beam actually doing in terms of its deflection? And are we going to be happy with that? And if you go through and you choose an individual beam, well, actually, let's do the other first thing first. I'll go to deformation as a tab. I'll turn off the moments. Go to deformation. Let's go ahead and show the deformation and say apply. Okay. What you can see there is that's the model of the slab actually deflecting, okay, as the members have deflected around it. So that's the slab. You see it sort of bows down in the center right now. I can turn that back off. Or if you want to, I can say show the deformation on the bars. Okay, and this is showing, you know, the actual kind of deformation in each of the different bars. So what's showing me right here is that sort of in the middle of that bar right now, in the middle of that bar across the front, we currently are deforming right around, it looks like right around 0.91 inches. Something like that, which may or may not be so good relative to what we want. So in terms of thinking about all these things, you can think about whether or not this beam is adequate, and we'll get some feedback about that. As you think about deflection, like what is a good deflection? Sort of what is a good guideline for deflection? So that, it's 1 inch right now, basically. Is that good? Is that bad? Is it okay? Ms. Jacqueline, you have done some structural analysis. As you talk about deflection, what kind of criterion do you use to sort of decide whether deflection is good or not?
L/360.
So L over 360. So explain to that. What's that?
It depends on
the spec. OK, so if, for example, I had something which was, 360 inches long, here, 30 feet long, yeah, how many inches can it deflect? With that? Excellent. Okay, so if this is 30 feet long, 1 inch is okay. If it's less than 30, that might be getting to be a little bit too much deflection. Okay, if it's short, if it's much less than L over 360, then yeah, you're A-okay in terms of it's not deflecting too much.
And it also depends on what you're using.
Yes.
So sometimes it's not really 360. So if you have some sensitive equipment, it might be like
2, 4 years of thing. Excellent. You're thinking just right. It all really depends on how much you want to allow relative to that length. And sometimes people use L over 360, sometimes they use L over 480, okay, which means even less deflection. Could be 240. 240 be allowing a little more deflection. Yeah, because it's dividing. Okay, so yeah, it really depends. Is it a kind of a standard kind of consumer floor? Is there some very sensitive precision equipment where vibrations would upset it? Then we might have a higher level. Even finishes. If you're going to put a lot of stone or tile that might crack if it deflected, you want to kind of cut that off too. Okay, so you sort of have different criteria. But what we're going to do is for any member, for example, this member right here, let me go ahead and take a look at its properties. We can sort of see this is just an isolated view of this thing. We can see it has its section, that's all fine. It has some properties, that's all fine. It has the shear and bending forces, that's all fine. We can kind of look at all those different sort of diagrams based upon what we want. We could even look at the very specific deflection diagram, sort of see that it's coming down to close to one. But what we're finally going to do is we're going to do this thing that says code check. And you'll see right here that per the code check, okay, this is not stable right now. There's something about it that's not quite working, okay? Chances are this might be, well, deflection might be okay. There's something else about it that's not quite right. And a really high-level way of looking at it is, there's this number right here called the efficiency ratio. The efficiency ratio you'll see right now says 1.16. Think of it this way. The closer you are to 1.0, the closer you are to maxing out the capacity. So if you have something with an efficiency ratio of 0.05, oh, it's greatly oversized relative to the need. 0.5, you're kind of halfway there. 0.9, you're getting close in terms of you may not want to get that high because if some unusual load comes into play, it might exceed 1. 1.19, okay, this means at some level, or 1.6, we're about 16% over or undersized. Okay, their loads are greater than what this beam can carry. Okay, so what we'll do together next time is we will go through and take some structures and think about resizing the beams and then bringing that information back to Revit. Just as a high level how it works, we can go through and actually go assess all the different beams very quickly. There's this whole tool within here called, under design, steel member design. And we can ask it to go through and do member verification. If you verify the members, it's going to go through all the different members and sort of rank them all in terms of whether they're good or bad. We'll do this together next time, so don't worry as I go through this really quickly, because we're about to finish up for today. I'll say any section, so just all 16 or 13 sections. I'll say let's go through and do some calculations. Actually, I try that again. Oh, there's the results. They're over there. You'll see at a high level, it looks like most of the things are actually kind of doing okay right now. There's really just a few, and I believe these are the big ones on both sides that aren't doing so well. If I look at the ratio, you'll see that many of the things, like the columns, only have an efficiency ratio of about 0.14. The girders on the sides are about 0.3. Many things are oversized right now, but those big girders on the end, 7 and 8, that carry so many of the other loads, they're undersized right now. So where we'll pick this up next time is we'll take a look at this list and this tool and how we could actually say either let us change an individual one of these and see whether it's okay, or how we can actually just say let's go through and have you choose the best size. Okay, giving the tool a list of potential sizes for each of the different members and then saying, okay, go through and choose the one that you would recommend as the best balance between a criteria like minimizing the weight, okay, versus the structural support that's needed. Okay, so a little bit of structural optimization next time. Okay, beautiful. Let us adjourn for today. As you are thinking about the weekend ahead and like just getting ready to kind of head into next week, please go ahead and if you can, check in with us before the week is out, although a few of you already have. Some of you are already scheduled to do that. Or plan to do it kind of at the very beginning of next week. But go ahead and take advantage of that because, you know, out of the meetings, you know, it's all really about helping you solve some of the problems you're encountering. So hopefully that'll be valuable to you in terms of getting some things just moving and getting you through some of the hurdles you're encountering. Because we're kind of at the point in most of our buildings where as you move beyond that just sort of general idea and you start getting specific about the structure and these, you know, all the little problems start surfacing. So let us help you figure out how to solve them. Okay, beautiful. Let us adjourn for today.